Good morning, Liberty Baptist Church.
Good morning.
It is so good to see you, and we invite you. We're glad you chose Liberty Baptist Church to worship this morning, and all of you that are joining us on Facebook or any other avenue that we have, we welcome you. We want to give our visitors a very special welcome and invite them to be back. On our website, we have right up the top, God's people doing God's work for God's glory. All right, as I say it, I want you to repeat it. God's people.
God's people.
Doing God's work.
Doing God's work.
For God's glory.
For God's glory.
Now, if you remember that, you got it all taken care of. So let's be busy about our place of responsibility. We have our free clothes giveaway Saturday, April the 6th. We will start a new study in our Bible study at 5 o'clock for the adults on the book of Acts. And what a fitting book, since we have emphasis on the Annie Armstrong Easter offering this month. So Sweet Spirit Singers will be going to Wilkeson County Nursing Home at
Thursday. We leave here at 9.
Leave here at 9. So whatever time we get there, we'll sing to these people. So then just pay attention to what's in our bulletins. And I'm going to read from the first chapter of Psalms. And it tells us, blessed is the man who walks not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the way of sinners, nor sitteth in the seat of scornful. But his delight is in the law of the Lord, and the law doth he meditate day and night. And he shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water that bringeth forth his fruit in his season. His leaf also shall not wither, and whatsoever he doeth shall prosper. The ungodly are not so, but are like the chaff which the wind driveth away. Therefore, the ungodly shall not stand in judgment, nor sinners in this congregation of the righteousness. For the Lord knoweth the way of the righteous, but the way of the ungodly shall perish. Let's pray. Our gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day and all its many, many blessings. And Lord, a special day in the life of Liberty Baptist Church. We want a special blessing upon Brother Burke and his family as they come. And as he preaches, just give him the words that you would have us to hear. Lead us, guide us, and keep us. For we ask in thy holy and most precious name. Amen.
Who's in my family? Yeah, if you looked at the picture of ours, we'd certainly look different. Oh, we have two biological children, we have three adopted children. So certainly if you look at the photo, you see brown hair, you see dark skin, you see blonde hair.
And certainly we do get very close, but the great thing is seeing the Lord work and do things that you never even dreamed possible.
The call to adopt came out of intimacy with the Lord, just like our calling to plant this church. I'm the church planting pastor of Refuge Church in the Ortega community of Jacksonville. I've been here about 2.5 years. It was a community that was very unreached, and being there, the Lord just began to kind of do something in our heart.
We didn't set out to plant a church for foster and adoptive families. It really just happened. The Lord did it.
A lot of our church has become people from this community who are fostering or who are adopted, so we share that in common. People are longing for community, and when you have a layer of taking on people and children from difficult places, it's not easy. It's not comfortable. I think the reason they've shown up here, there's a big closet full of diapers and shoes and strollers and car seats, and they see that and they come here to get a need met. That they build a relationship. Next thing we know, they're in our church on a Sunday, and I think about the amount of children who come to our church who, if families didn't say yes to foster care and adoption, those children would never hear about Jesus. They'd never hear the gospel. This is the calling that God has for us, and when people give to Annie Armstrong, you're able to support those who are on the front lines of gospel work, and people hear the gospel who would never have a chance to hear the gospel.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I want to introduce our pastoral candidate to you this morning. Brother Brock Burch is here with his wife, Taylor, and their three little girls, Rebecca, Lydia, and Mary Catherine. Many of you got to meet them and speak with them last night, but I want to give you some information about them this morning. Brother Burch was licensed to the ministry in 2012, ordained in 2016. He is currently serving at Liberty Baptist Church in Flowood. His education through the New Orleans Baptist Theological Seminary is a bachelor's in Christian ministry with a minor in Christian education and biblical studies in 2016, a master of divinity in 2019, and he will complete his doctor of ministry with a specialization in educational ministries in May. Experience consists of he's currently serving as Minister of Adult Education, Discipleship, and Students. He has served as a senior pastor in a previous church for 4 years and as a student minister. Other experience, volunteer experience, he has served as Church Relations Coordinator for Southwest and Central Mississippi for Operation Christmas Child, Vice President of Southwest Mississippi Pro-Life, DNOW Bible Study Leader. He is trained as a chaplain for Louisiana Baptist Disaster Relief, summer camp staff volunteer at Camp Fuego, Two Rivers Association Youth Minister, Camp Living Waters, Board of Directors, and South Pike High School chaplain. He has made several international mission trips to London, Brazil, Guatemala, Egypt, and Israel. He and his wife are from the Kentwood and Mount Hermon area, and they currently live in Brandon. One of the things that Brother Brock shared with us during our process was that he and his wife were searching for a place of ministry where they could have some stability for their three girls, for their family, and their growing family. The first thing he wants to do is to get to know the people of the church. And he has a passion for missions, for sharing the gospel, and for reaching the community outside the church. So Brother Brock will bring our message this morning after our special music.
Thank you, Marcia, so much. Busy day today. Let's stand, please, as we sing our fellowship hymn, "He Has Made Me Glad." Fellowship together.
I will enter his gates with thanksgiving in my heart. I will enter his courts with praise. I will say this is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice for he has made me glad. He has made me glad. He has made me glad. I will rejoice for he has made me glad. He has made me glad. He has made me glad. I will rejoice for he has made me glad. I will enter his gates with thanksgiving in my heart. I will enter his courts with praise. I will say this is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice for he has made me glad. He has made me glad. He has made me glad. I will rejoice for he has made me glad. He has made me glad. He has made me glad. I will rejoice for he has made me glad. In Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my storm. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drop and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are sealed, when striving cease, my comforter, precious blood of Christ. No power in death, no fear in death. This is the power of Christ in me. From life's first cry to final breath, Jesus commands my destiny. No power of hell, no scheme of man can ever pluck me from his hand till he returns or calls me home. Here in the power of Christ I stand.
I want to go right to the offertory hymn. And we're going to sing the first verse a cappella. Holy, holy, holy. Okay? And if you can sing alto, tenor, or bass, sing with me. Ready?
Holy, holy, holy.
Thank you. Romans 6:23 says that the wages we earn for our sin is death. It is a debt each of us must pay one way or another. That verse goes on to say that God decided to give us a gift. Instead of death, we can accept the gift of eternal life. This gift is available to us because Jesus paid the debt for us when he took our sins to the cross.
Oh, to him I owe. Well, good morning.
Good morning.
I'm glad to be here. Thank you, choir. Thank you, Brother Hugh, for leading us in worship this morning. Thank you, church, for being a gracious host this weekend. We're excited to be here. This morning is a big day in the life of your church. You are, in a moment, going to vote on your next pastor. That's a big moment. But there's another big moment here. It's Sunday, and we're here to meet with the Lord. And let's not overshadow the fact that we're here to hear from Him first this morning. He has a word for us. So these next few moments, I want you to look past me as a man and look to Jesus. And I want you to hear from Him this morning. So if you have your Bibles, you can turn with me to 2 Corinthians chapter 5. 2 Corinthians chapter 5 is going to be in verses 14 to 21. This morning we're going to focus in on our gift and our purpose. We each have received a gift and we each have a purpose here. And so we're going to find what Paul has shares with us in this passage. Once you find, if you would stand in honor of reading God's word together. Second Corinthians chapter 5, beginning in verse 14. It says, "For the love of Christ controls us, having concluded this, that one died for all, therefore all died. And he died for all, so that they who live might no longer live for themselves, but for him who died and rose again on their behalf. Therefore, from now on, we recognize no one according to the flesh. Even though we have known Christ according to the flesh, yet now we know him in this way no longer. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old things passed away, behold, the new things have come. Now all these things are from God, who reconciled us to himself through Christ and gave us the ministry of reconciliation, namely that God was in Christ reconciling the world to himself, not counting their trespasses against them. He has committed to us the word of reconciliation. Therefore, we are ambassadors for Christ, as though God were making an appeal through us. We beg you on behalf of Christ, be reconciled to God. He made him who knew no sin to be sin on our behalf so that we might become the righteousness of God in him." Pray with me. God, we just thank you for your word. And God, we pray now as we look at it and study it, God, over these next few moments, God, we pray that you would speak to us. God, we just thank you for your love, your grace, and mercy. We thank you for the cross. It's in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. So the first thing we want to look at and see in this passage is our gift. Our gift. And then you can go ahead and hit the next. There we go. Our gift. In verse 14, we see a phrase that says, "The love of Christ controls us." That word, that verb that's there for controls, only appears in the New Testament one other time in the entire New Testament. This verb can mean to hold together, to include, to enclose, to hold fast. However, in this context, it means we have no choice. That Christ's self-sacrificial love restrains Paul from self-seeking, but might seem to the casual observer a powerless death on the cross actually exerts enormous power for the good to those who will submit to it. The love of Christ keeps us from living for ourselves instead of focusing on pouring our life into others. Let me ask you a question this morning. Can you share that the love of Christ controls you? Does it compel you to everything that you do? In order for that to happen, you have to have a relationship with Jesus. You have to know him. You have had to experience him. Paul, who is writing this, remembers the Damascus Road. You recall in Acts chapter 9, Paul at that time was Saul, was on his way to Damascus in order to persecute the church. He was going to find those who were called Christians or part of the way at that time in order for them to be killed. And along the way, Jesus shows up and he blinds him and he says, Saul, why are you persecuting me? He says, who are you? I'm Jesus, the one you're persecuting, the living God. Jesus met him, showed up, and Saul's life was never the same. He never got over that moment where he realized that the living Savior saved him and he didn't deserve it. Let me share with you, when Jesus met me in January of 2000 at a John Jacobs and the Power Team event at First Baptist Church, Franklinton, I didn't deserve it. I was a sinner on my way to hell, which is what I deserved. And I heard the preacher that got up after the event share the gospel, and I realized my sin. And I recognized that I was a sinner who had went against the will of God. Here's the thing. What is sin? It's doing anything that does not exalt a holy God. Lying, gossiping. Guess who's guilty? All of us. The Bible says all of us have sinned. And I recognized my sin. I realized I needed Jesus. And I turned and repented of my sins and trusted Jesus. And here's the thing. From that moment on, his love should have compelled, controlled the way I walk in my life. He should have been the number one thing controlling my life. That should be how what we all should be able to say. When Paul's writing here now, I never should get over the fact that God saved me from hell. I should never get over the fact that God saved me from an eternity of never knowing him. I should never get over that fact. And in fact, because of that, it should compel me to live for him. That we've been given a gift in the fact of our salvation because we did not do anything to earn it. But God has given us this. Allow his love to control your life. Walk in obedience. The second thing that we see here, verse 15, is that Jesus died for all. It says, having concluded that once died for all, therefore all died. This is referring to the curse of sin. When Adam sinned, sinner in the world, every human on them had a sinful nature. We're all sinners and deserving of death. Every sin is deserving of death. Of death, not just physical, but a spiritual death, a separation from God for all of eternity. And this is what we deserve. This was our just punishment. Death. Death. We deserved that. That's what I earned. And if someone asks me, Brock, what do you earn? I earned hell. That was where I earned. My wickedness, my sinfulness, I earned a place in hell. Jesus, through his grace, through his mercy, through his blood on the cross, and my faith in him, can I be declared holy and righteous and enter into the kingdom of heaven. Nothing of Brock. We all sinned. But Jesus stepped into our sin. Romans 5:8 says, but God showed his love to us that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. I want you to think about that for a moment. Jesus came as a substitute for your sin. God's wrath had to be poured out onto sin. God's holy and he's just. He would not be just to say, well, you know, they had a little bit of sin, but they were an okay person. I'm going to let them slide. That wouldn't be just. His punishment had to be poured out on sin. And Jesus stepped towards that wrath, and he took on the cross. He took on all the sin of the world, never sinned, and yet he became sin for us. He died for all of humanity. He died for the ones that were putting the nails into his hands. In Luke 23, we see where he cries out on the cross, Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they're doing. They do not know what they're doing. The one who created the universe loved you enough to step into towards you in your sin and to die for you. Don't you think about this? In the moments that you don't want anyone to know about, your most sinful moment that you hope goes to the grave and you don't hope no one here in this room knows and finds out about. Jesus saw you in that moment. And he loved you in that moment enough to die for you. He loved you in the moment that you said, I'm just unlovable right now. I'm a mess. My life is a mess. I have wandered away from God. I have wandered away from the ways of God. Jesus loved you in that moment, and he stepped towards you, and he went to the cross for you in that moment. Because there was no way for you to save yourself, and he still loved his creation. And he stepped towards you, and he went to the cross for you and made a way for you to have a relationship with him. But not only do we see that Jesus died for all, he makes us into a new creature. It says in verse 17, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creature. For the old things have passed away, behold, new things have come. If anyone is in Christ, he is a new creature. For all that is saved, if you are saved, he has transformed your life. He transforms you into a new creature. The word creature literally means created thing. But we're talking about God, who is the creator of all things, right? So he is the creator. We are created beings. We are creatures of God. And we were created, if you go back to Genesis 1, to be in his image. We had a way that we were supposed to be. We were supposed to be image bearers of a holy God. Well, we messed that up. Genesis 3, the fall happens, and our image is all distorted. And every time we sin, we distort that image even more. But God still loved us, and he sent Jesus. And then, as we are saved and we are redeemed through the blood of Jesus, Jesus creates us into a new creature. And so the old has passed away. Your sinful self, your sinful desires, the flesh, it passes away, and the new comes. You become righteous through the blood of Jesus. You can become holy through the blood of Jesus. You become that image bearer again through the blood of Jesus that God once intended for you to be. You become the person of God that he has intended for you to be. He transforms us. You have been forgiven. He has made you new. But here's what that means. The old desire should pass away. So that means the desires to sin should no longer continue to stay with us. So often I think we share the gospel and we think, okay, well, if I know Jesus, that's my get out of hell free card. But that's not what the Bible says. Right? It's not that I just get Jesus and I live how I want 6 days a week if I show up on church on Sunday. That's not what the Bible says. See, Jesus says, when I save you, I become the Lord of your life, and I'm going to transform you to where my love controls you, so you should walk in obedience to me, so where the world outside, the other 6 days, should see that you're a follower of me. So that happens, my life should reflect holiness all days. So if I was a person who had a drinking issue or a cursing issue or an anger issue in the old, when I become new, I should be a person of love and a person of patience and a person who, when people look and say, there's a changed person through the blood of Jesus. So it's not that I did, it was through the blood of Jesus. So when we look at our lives, we should be able to see a change, a transformation, the fact that we became a new creature through Jesus. Our gift is the new life in Christ, the gift of the gospel, being made new into a new creature. If you're here this morning, you've never experienced that, we're going to have a time of invitation later. Today would be a great day for you to receive the gift of salvation. If you're here and you may still be lost and you've never accepted this gift, it's a gift. Again, I didn't do anything to deserve it. You didn't do anything to deserve it. Jesus did all the work. And it's freely offered to you. Today would be a great day of salvation. But then what did he say we do afterwards? He gives us a job. We have a purpose. So what is our purpose? We have the, you can click the next one, the ministry of reconciliation. Beginning in verse 18, it says, "Now all these things are from him who reconciled us to himself through Christ and gave us the ministry of reconciliation." What is reconciliation? Reconciliation is something that takes place when you have a broken relationship and you're trying to mend it. Now, as a minister or pastor, I've been part of trying to reconcile people together. Sometimes it worked, sometimes they weren't following Jesus, so it did not work out. But the idea that you're trying to mend a relationship, well, guess what? We were broken to God. Our relationship with God was broken. And the way that it got fixed is through Jesus. Guess whose relationship with God is still broken? The world. And guess whose task it is to take that message to the world? The church. We have the only message that can change the world. It doesn't matter who we elect. It doesn't matter who's in office. The church has the only message that can change the world. Church, you have been given the most powerful message in the world. The message of the gospel is a message that can change hearts and lives. And you've been entrusted with it. You have been entrusted with the message that Jesus saves. And that he still saves sinners. And he loves sinners and died for them. And the third day he rose again victoriously so that they could have life. And life everlasting. Church, that's the message that you have that you can share. That to be reconciled to God. We've been given that task. We look around and we see a broken world. And sometimes we can even, if we are not careful, we can become judgmental to this broken world. We can look around and we can say, and there's just no hope for them. That's just the way those people are. Instead, we need to look at them the way in Matthew chapter 9, Jesus looked at the broken world. And he sees them lost. Like sheep without a shepherd. Because the world hasn't found their shepherd yet. They need Jesus. And guess who's called to take them that message? You are. I am. The church is. We've been given a ministry. So you've been commissioned into the ministry of reconciliation by the Lord Jesus through his word. To call people to be reconciled to God. And not only does he say that, he goes on. In verse 20, it says, "Therefore we are all ambassadors for Christ. And so, God, we are making an appeal through us. We beg you, on behalf of Christ, be reconciled to God." We are begging people to come to Jesus. We are ambassadors for Christ. And ambassadors, A modern ambassador is a spokesperson on behalf of a government official or president. Well, guess who you're a spokesperson for? The Lord Jesus. You are speaking on behalf of Jesus to the world, and you are begging them to be reconciled to God. When you're at the Piggly Wiggly, you are finding people in there, and you're saying, I beg you to be reconciled to God. When you're on your street and you know you have a neighbor who's lost, you are begging them to be reconciled to God. When you're at work and you know you have a lost coworker, you should be begging them to be reconciled to God. When you have a family member who you know has not come to know the Lord, you should be begging them to be reconciled to God. Because here's the thing, we know the story if they don't get saved. We know our gift that we were saved from hell. And here's the thing, that's their destiny if they don't get saved. We also know the love and the peace that is found in Jesus, and we should desire for them to have that. Our desire should be that everyone in Liberty knows Jesus. And then from Liberty, you say everyone in Mississippi knows Jesus. And then from there, everyone in the United States, and then everyone in the world knows Jesus. That should be our desire. That all would come to know Jesus. Do you hear Paul's brokenness in his writing? Begging people. Let me ask you, when was the last time that you were prayed and you were broken over the fact there's people dying every day going to hell? Dying without Jesus. So I grew up in this area, and sometimes I think growing up in this area, we can get to a point where we're just like, well, people just know Jesus. Right? Like, they just, everyone around here, like, it's just a known thing. Well, when I was a youth minister in Kentwood, we did an Easter event at a park, and we were setting up for it, and this little kid shows up at it, and he's asking us what we're doing, and we're telling him, hey, we're going to have an Easter event, and we start sharing with him the story of Easter. He came back and he said, y'all are lying to me. And we're like, what are you talking about? What do you mean you were lying? He said, well, people don't rise from the dead. He had never heard of the resurrection. He lived 10 minutes from me at the time. And he had never heard of the resurrection. There are people here who have never heard of Jesus. Now, I remember going to Egypt, and that was my first time to ever experience spiritual darkness when I got off the plane. It was a 97% Muslim country, and I got off the plane. We went during Ramadan, which that's a very spiritual time for Muslims, and we went to share the gospel with them. And I remember just getting off the plane and just feeling the weight of darkness. But you don't have to go there to find it. There's people on your street who don't know Jesus. There may be people in your family who don't know Jesus. There may be people at your work who don't know Jesus. There's people in the grocery store who don't know Jesus. You're called to be Jesus wherever you're at right now. Here's some new stats that just came out from the North American Mission Board I want to share. In the past 6 months, only 38% of Christians share the gospel with a loved one. And 30% share the gospel with a stranger. 52% of self-identified Christians agree that encouraging someone to change religious beliefs is offensive and disrespectful. And only 51% of churches saw evangelism as a priority. Jesus calls us to share the gospel. It's a powerful message. It's not an option yet. Only 3 out of 10 people have shared the gospel in the last 6 months. Only half our churches believe it's a priority. And half of the Christians are more concerned about feelings rather than sending someone to hell for eternity. Lord, help us. Charles Spurgeon said that every Christian is a missionary or an imposter. Which one are you? See, this is when God called us to be saved, He called us to get to work. That's what Paul writes in Ephesians 2. It says, so you were saved through grace for faith. But then verse 10, you were saved for His workmanship. You've been saved to take this message to everyone who hasn't heard it. Church, God has great plans for His church, but He calls His church to be faithful. A faithful church is going to be about His work and His purpose. So this morning, as we come to a time of invitation, I've got two questions. Number one, do you know Him? Have you received the gift of salvation? Does His love control your life? But then secondly, are you living with His purpose? Are you sharing the message of Jesus? Don't raise your hand. Right? Don't raise your hand when I ask this, but if that question was given to you, would you be able to say, yes, you've shared the gospel in the last 6 months? See, if we love Jesus and we haven't, then we're not living with purpose. Because you can't tell me that there's not somebody you could have told. Somebody you could have told. Our time's too precious and the message is too important. However the Lord is speaking to you this morning, respond in obedience. I'll be here to pray with you, but respond in obedience. Let's pray together. God, we just thank you for who you are. God, we pray now as we come to this time of invitation, God, that we would respond in obedience to you. God, if there's one here that does not know you, God, I pray today will be a day of salvation. God, I pray for the rest that do know you. God, that this could be a day that we would commit to be living on purpose for you. God, we love you and we praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's stand as we sing.
Take up thy cross and follow me. I heard my master say, I gave
Brother Brock. Congregation, you may be seated.
As announced Wednesday, and in accordance with our church policies, I call us to order for a special business meeting to consider the call of Brother Brock Burch to be our new pastor. Visitors, you're welcome to stay or to leave. I will shortly call on Marcia Talbert to come and read the motion for the call of Brother Burch. Only members will vote. I'm going to ask the ushers to pass out little ballots. Please write yes or no to the question that will be before you, again, which Ms. Marcia will read. After folks have had an adequate time to write their response. I'm asking that the ushers take up these ballots and then to take them back here to the Bicota room, the pastor's old study, and for Mike Tynes, Daniel Lambert, Gary Steen, Warren Leak, and Will Caston to tally those votes for us and bring us back. After they have left out, we will have a closing prayer. You can then stay or not. We'll close out the meeting and we will report the vote afterwards or Wednesday night. So, with that in all in mind, Ms. Marshall, will you come forward and read the motion and all agreements that have been made with Brother Burch, should he be called?
The Pastor Search Committee consists of Will Caston, Charles Causey, Beth Haygood, Gary Steen, and myself. We are unanimous in presenting this candidate to the church. We have met with he and his wife and had multiple phone conversations with them. All of our questions have been answered fully and satisfactorily. We've done the background check and the finance committee. We've been in discussions with the finance committee and with Brother Brock to come to an agreement concerning his compensation. The deacons and the church council have also been well represented in the committee. He and his wife have prior obligations that they need to meet before they can move here full time. She's a teacher under contract until the end of May. He also has a international mission trip that he's already been planned in July 5th through 13th, and we'll give him release time for that. If we vote to accept him, his official start date will be April 21st. And from that date until May 1st, his weekly schedule would be from Friday afternoon through Sunday night service, Mondays 9 to 3, and Wednesday evenings until May 1st when he would be here full time. With input from the Finance Committee, we have agreed on the budgeted salary of $63,000 a year, convention expense of $2,500, auto expense of the current budgeted amount of $7,000. This is for out-of-town visitation and travel to state convention, and moving expenses up to $2,500. And we are putting that before you in the form of a motion.
All right, the ushers will pass out the ballots to members. If you're a member, raise your hand, let them give you a ballot. If you are a member of Liberty Baptist Church, whether you're 8 or 98, you can vote. Baptist Church is the most democratic organizations that exist. Please only mark your ballot yes or no to the call of Brother Burch under the, with all of the conditions, compensation, et cetera, noted. I hope there are pencils in front of you or behind you if you're sitting on the front. I've made an attempt to put one in every little place. All right, if you've voted, there's one, thank you. All right, if the ushers will now take up the ballots after you voted yourself. I I'm only going to vote in case of a tie. Oh. Or if it'll change your vote. So y'all see, I haven't marked anything. If it comes in 48 to 48, I'll make sure it's a decision one way or the other. All right, after y'all gathered them, if Daniel, you'll go back and Will, Warren, Gary, and Mike. All right, if you would, let's, do you have a song you want to do? All right, we'll let this song close us out.
Let's stand, please.
Jesus, 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 sweetest name I know, fills my every longing, keeps me singing as I go.
And you are dismissed.
Clay Caston just made a motion to close out our special business meeting, and James seconded it. All in favor, leave. Opposed, stay.